Namaste and welcome to the overview of Payment of Bonus Act 1965. The Act is a welfare legislation procuring the employees a share in the profits of a concern. It was a conscious effort from the government to raise bonus from the level of a gratis from the employers to that of a statutory reward for efforts of the employee. The Act prescribes the scheme of bonus with a formula and clearly defines its components. It also provides for a mechanism of monitoring and redressal of grievances. The scheme provides for annual bonus with a minimum and maximum ceiling and an enforcement mechanism in place. The Act aims at creating a statutory obligation to pay bonus and links it to profits, production, and productivity. Applicability covers every factory under Factories Act and every other establishment employing 20 or more persons on any day during last accounting year. The coverage continues even where the staff strength of an establishment falls below 20. It's like once covered, always covered. The government also has the discretion to cover establishments where the staff strength is less than 20 but above 10. We should also note that for counting the strength of employees, all departments, divisions, branches are considered as part of a single entity. More particularly, when they have got a sole consolidated profit and loss account for reporting the annual results. The definition of employees covered by the scheme, it excludes apprentices, but generous enough to include all other denominations such as temporary employees, probationers, dismissed employees, resigned employees, of course, subject to meeting the wage ceiling and the minimum service requirement during the accounting. The first 5 years of a company are exempt from bonus payment. But if in any of the 5 years profit is reported, bonus becomes compulsory from that year itself. Worth noting that losses in subsequent years does not make any difference and they are not relevant. As for disqualified employees, there is one provision regarding forfeiture of bonus. Where an employee is dismissed for fraud or violent behavior or theft and misappropriation, his bonus can be totally forfeited and it is not restricted only to the relevant financial year. It is for all years present and future. Whereas there are employees who are guilty of misconduct causing financial loss, they are at a level which is having a bit of liberal treatment. What the Act states is, out of their bonus, whatever loss caused to the company could be recovered, but the balance has to be paid back to them. And this action of recovery pertains to only that accounting year. It cannot be carried forward to the future or it can be effected in the past. There are certain organizations which are kept outside the scope of the Act, like LIC, GIC, RBI, IFCI, UTI, educational institutions, social welfare institutions, financial institutions notified by the central government. And the government can add or delete to this list. But worth noting that all these organizations, for the sake of parity, have internally an equally rewarding ex gratia payment system, and which is a consolation for their respective employees. As for the rate of wages as bonus, the statutory minimum is 8.33% of wages earned. The minimum wage based bonus is independent of availability of profits. If profits permit, maximum permissible bonus is up to 20% of the lower of ₹7,000 or wages earned. To be eligible for the bonus during a year, an employee should have put in a service of minimum 30 working days, and the working days include layoff, paid leave, maternity and absence due to temporary disablement. Employers have got an option to set off the amount paid as puja bonus or interim bonus or any other bonuses while making payment of the final statutory bonus, unless such payment, when it was made, there was an agreement between the employer and the employee that this shall not be available to be adjusted against annual bonus. Meaning, it depends on the understanding between the two parties. Now let's get into the calculation of profits for bonus. The first stage is deciding the available surplus. The process is very simple. You first start with the net profit as reported in the profit and loss account, and you pass adjustments for four specific sets of items specified in the Payment of Bonus Act. Now, what are these four specific adjustments to be passed? Depreciation, as admissible under Income Tax Act, has to be given effect. Development rebate or investment allowance permitted under the Income Tax Act has to be incorporated. Any direct tax which is payable by the employer for the current year for the profits and gains and income has to be built into this working. And a provision has to be made on notional returns of three items which are mentioned in third schedule to the Act. One is dividend at the rates agreed on preference share capital, 8.5% on the equity share capital in the beginning of the accounting period, 6% on the opening balance of reserves. When the net profit as per the profit and loss account is adjusted with these four items, the resulting figure is called as available surplus. Available surplus leads us to allocable surplus. Simple. Allocable surplus is nothing but 60% of available surplus. In case of foreign companies, instead of 60, percentage of 67 is applied. Now from available surplus, we move to allocable surplus, and allocable surplus is the amount which is material for payment of bonus. We have got two sets of figures at this point in time. One is allocable surplus, and the other is the balance of set on or set off carried forward. And from here, taking the two together, we decide, should we pay minimum bonus, should we pay possible bonus, or should we pay maximum bonus? Now, when is minimum bonus paid? If the allocable surplus which we derived is not sufficient for paying minimum bonus, then as a matter of mandate, we pay minimum bonus, shortfall or deficit is carried forward. Going to the next option, if the allocable surplus is above the minimum bonus, then what we will do is, we will see how we can distribute it fully after setting off or setting on balance in the beginning. Means, second situation is where you pay more than minimum bonus, but you may not be able to pay the maximum bonus. Third situation is when you have got surplus which is more than maximum bonus. In such a case, you will pay maximum bonus, and whatever surplus is there, you carry forward along with set on and set off. It is just a mechanism of asking three questions: are we below the minimum, or are we above the minimum, or are we above the maximum? These three options help us decide how much to pay, how much to carry forward. But under all circumstances, bonus shall be paid, being not less than the statutory minimum of 8.33%. Now comes the payment time limit. Payment has to be made within 8 months of the year end. Normally, year ends in March 31st. Therefore, 8 months after that is 30th November. Before 30th November, it has to be paid. This is regarding the bonus. If there is an award regarding bonus, it has to be paid within a month of the award. What are employers' obligations? Simple, the process of maintaining records, paying bonus, filing annual returns, and facilitating the visit of inspector and providing him all information and records required. If you fulfill these four, you have discharged your duties as an employer. And for compliance purpose, there is an inspector, and this inspector's functions and his rights are almost similar to the inspector under Factories Act, who also takes care of payment of wages as well as Minimum Wages Act. His powers are almost the same: to inspect, demand information, call for records, take copies, hear the parties, summon them, and come to a conclusion as to are the compliances in order or whether there is an issue of non-compliance. Just like all other acts, contracting out is null and void. Any contract against the rights given under the statutory bonus between employer and employee cannot be enforced. And this may not be applicable to customary bonus. Customary bonus is an issue away from the statutory bonus. Any issues pertaining to the payment of bonus and its components could be pursued as an industrial dispute under the Industrial Disputes Act. Means you can approach the relevant authorities for redressal. And there are cases where the employer fails to make payment of bonus within time and the appropriate amount. The employee has got a right to approach the relevant authorities. He can do it directly or through any of his representatives or assignees in case of his death. They may apply to the appropriate authority for recovery of money due, but this application has to be made within 1 year from the date the money became due. And the appropriate authority or the court or the tribunal, as the case may be, they may hear the case and pass an order by issuing a certificate which is issued to the collector of the district. And the collector, through the certificate, shall proceed to recover the amount of outstanding bonus as an arrear of land revenue. This is very, very strong power available with the collector, even to seize assets and sell them off to recover the amount as a land revenue. The Act also provides for penalties against offences which are listed therein. It is advisable for every employer to prepare and maintain registers, records and other documents in a form as prescribed. And the Act is always employer-employee friendly. A gentle reminder, if not done already, please click the like or dislike button, subscribe to the channel, click the bell notification. Please comment for improvement. Thanks a lot. Thank you so much.